This video series is about the concerns of over 300 citizens who have written letters or signed petitions about the plan of One World Health Center to build two four-story structures in front of our Omaha Livestock Exchange Building, listed on the Federal and Regional Registry of Historic Places. These are just a few of those concerned citizens. A particular worry is the building on the north or the right side of your screen, which would block the glorious view we have from L Street, a view thousands of tourists enjoy of this building. Also, that proposed north building on the right side of your screen will replace the lovely playground that now exists for some of the 50 or so children living in the building. We have major fears about chemicals stored nearby or emitted from nearby businesses. Concerns about the lack of outdoor recreational outlets for the families and scores of elderly residents that are slated to occupy the upper two levels of subsidized housing in each building. Thank you for taking the time to listen to what we have to say.
My name is Gary Kastrick. I'm an SOB. I grew up in South Omaha, maybe about a mile from the stockyards. I give tours, or as we say in South Omaha, tours of South Omaha. And my dad was an aristocrat in South Omaha. That means he was a good bartender. And when you're a good bartender in South Omaha, you get asked to do bartending at all the bars. And that's what I did. I used to have to bring him supper at these bars, and I'd go to these places, and that's when I started becoming interested in the people. And I'd walk in, and what I saw more than anything else was Emerson's idea of all people lead lives of quiet desperation. You could see these people that were working 12 hours and 14 hours so that their kids wouldn't have to, and you saw them put food on the table, and you saw the boners come in with their fingers cut off, and you saw the people working in the cold storage with the arthritis, and the different smells. You could tell whether or not they were in the hog yards or the cow yards or sheep yards, the smell or the blood that was on their boots. So I became fascinated with the concept of the people of South Omaha. And in becoming fascinated with the people of South Omaha, you become fascinated with people from all the industrial areas and how these people are held together by this working class mentality, by this idea that they were going to be working 14 hours a day. And they, you know, and the bars, for example, was a place of refuge where they'd have to run to just to get in the fact that's what they were doing with their whole life. Now that there's a t-shirt out now, it's kind of funny from a bar. It says, I survived, you know, the stockyards going down, and I survived the packing houses, and I'm still in South Omaha. Well, I think the last venue that we have of the stockyards and of what South Omaha was the Livestock Exchange Building. I'm pleased that they saved it. But just because you save a building doesn't mean you necessarily can just do what you want with it. I mean, if they painted it purple with polka dots right now, I mean, what would we say? I mean, they act like somehow now we saved it, now it's ours to do it what we want. The historical facts don't have to stay there. And you have to be vigilant, because it doesn't take but a different administration or a different group of people or people that have no regard for it that can change it, and then it's done. This building was built as a monument to South Omaha. By the time we got in the 1920s, the stockyards had become so large and so profitable and so special that they decided they needed something more than the small one they had. And so they wanted something that big. They wanted an 11-story building like that in that H formation. It was Kiewit's first million-dollar building. And as I look at it today, and I walk around there and I look at it and I say, my God, you know, there are no problems with this building. I dare you to find a crack. I dare you to find a split. I dare you to find a problem in the front with the Romanesque decorations in the front. You know, in 1933, 7 years after this thing was built, it was picked by Harper Bazaar as the most beautiful front of a building in the United States. So to do something to this building, it's like it stands there and represents what was there in that entire area. So to do something to block the view, to crowd it, to redo it, everything else, what that does to it is it takes away the whole concept of who we are and what we are. The building itself is irreplaceable. Very few people have ever really taken the time to look. For example, look under those windows. Under each window, there's a different design brickwork. I was told by people that constructed people that that'd be impossible to reproduce. It'd be too expensive right now. It represented the whole concept of South Omaha. And when I see that they want to put crowding buildings in front for the sake of crowding, when there are other alternatives, other land places. I've noticed that about Omaha. It's very interesting. Is it a point of view where you have to knock down something or hide something when we have so much plentiful land? When they knocked down, for example, the Medical Art Building, why did they need to put the building there? There was plenty of land around there of lesser substance that they could have put it there. But I believe sometimes we get this idea that somehow by destroying something magnificent, what makes our part even more magnificent, kind of like a relationship. And I really believe that the people who still have an inkling of South Omaha, just imagine years from now when there's no more people alive who have a concept of what was there, the world's largest stockyards. Now, I know it's just the stockyards, but to us it was a way of life. To us it was symbolic. To us it was who we were. And the smell, it was part of it. And what people don't realize too is with that building, they were planning in the 50s to put a elevated walkway to a hotel, and across the street, the Sutherland Lumber area, they were actually contemplating putting a shopping mall there. So they had big plans for this. They had big plans for this building. So to just decide, well, we need more space, so we're going to put in the disposable buildings in front of this magnificent structure that represented everything that people brought together to actually formulate that, the city of South Omaha, and later South Omaha itself as part of Omaha. It's absurd. It's ridiculous. It's what we do in Omaha. It's Jobber Canyon all over again in a smaller scale. We're on the viaduct of L Street here. I remember the old viaduct, and I still remember the sign in 1955 that we were so proud of. There was a sign that was up, and it said, "Help Omaha become the largest livestock center in the world." And when, in 1955, it became the largest, they crossed out help, and they put Omaha, the largest livestock in the world. And my dad, who didn't even live, didn't work in the livestock exchange, he didn't work in the packing houses, he was a custodian and a bartender, he was proud. He came by and pointed it out to me. Look at that. So you have to understand that we are ourselves in our circumstances. And the Stockyards was our circumstances. And I think a lot of people made the best of those circumstances. So as we look down on this, I give tours of South Omaha for third graders. And which is really fantastic is I bring third graders from way out west who have never been past 96th Street. And one of my key goals is to break down borders. To break down these borders. You can come to South Omaha. Nothing will happen to you. You can go to North Omaha. Nothing will happen to you. You're missing out on the ambiance and the food and the people and the reality of what's going on in the whole city. And so as I drive by here I am, I'm going to say, there's the livestock, oh no, wait a minute, there's two buildings and there's the livestock exchange building behind it. I also give tours for the Western Heritage Museum. Now what amazes me more than anything else is South Omaha is not a glamorous place. It's not the mansions. It's not the economics, it's not nothing like that. It's a working, stiff, working class area, and yet my trolleys are full. And the reason for that is because South Omaha is a character in itself. It's South Omaha, and it represents all the silly, crazy, heart-wrenching, sometimes awful things that happen down there. And to survive, it became almost a cartoon character, and the people love to come down there because we can laugh. I've never seen people with such dark humor that could laugh so much. And this whole, the one last vestige we have of what South Omaha is this building. It was important. And what I'm starting to see too is that old adage, you don't know what you got till it's gone. Why, I ask people, why weren't you down there getting the wood? Why weren't you down there doing this? Okay, they weren't. Why weren't you taking photos of this as it was going down, when we knew it was going down? Why didn't we preserve that last vestige, you know, of what South Omaha is? But we do have it. We have it in this building. Everett Buckingham, the man who was the head of the livestock or the stockyards at that time period, was a magnanimous man. And let me tell you a story that happened. The viaduct in front of this magnificent building is called Everett Buckingham Viaduct. And the reason was that when he died, he had one of the largest funerals in front of this building. And the reason was because when he was head of the livestock exchange, he sent men out and people out to make sure everybody in South Omaha had enough coal and food. So when he died, phone calls were coming in saying, are you still going to be sending people out here to get coal and food? We're standing in front of a vestige of people down in a selling in a stockyards in the mud and the muck and the crap and the shit and all this. And yet at the same time, the one thing that was permanent in that area was a handshake. Billions of dollars was transferred in there without a signed piece of paper. It was all in a handshake. And it was all done in this building. This building was a little city. This building had banks and restaurants, and it had a bar and a cigar store and a beauty shop and a barber shop and its own post office and apartments and a commissioner's. And it also had, on top there, it had magnificent ballrooms that everybody did their weddings at, and the weddings would converge on both sides. I mean, you literally could go into Omaha, go into that building, and never have to leave. And when I interviewed people that used to bring their livestock into Omaha, the thing they remember is going in there and eating and getting the haircut and going upstairs and shopping and then going all through South Omaha. Now, the other vestige of South Omaha history, the Phillips and the Roseland and all that, is all gone. It's turned into new enterprises, which is wonderful. And South Omaha itself is wonderful because it's a vestige. It's a place where immigrants feel they can come. It's always been that way. And what's happening in South Omaha now is magnificent. But like I told my students as I taught at South High School, I want you to understand the history of this place. Because I said, whenever I appreciate an area and I know the history, I start appreciating my part in it and that I'm part of that drama. That it's just not popping up out of nowhere right now. That I'm going to be part of that drama. I'm going to someday be part of that history.